good for everyone.
What state Phoebe is from either, but she hasn't really been like playing too often these days. But back when she started out, she had a really fast climb to being a very good player. So, and then CSAS, yeah, it's just that scary of a character to where if you're not in the right headspace, it's like impossible to react to what that character's doing. So, she's a tilter. She's a tilter. For sure.
Yeah, 100%. I think it's really interesting thinking about a lot of multi-level matches where, or ways to approach the game, where if you play other fighting games and you're like solid in your game and you come to Code Current, I feel like it's not too hard to just pick up and be able to just play the game, right? Like, you know, the easy launcher, DBC, JBC, yeah, air throw combos. Like,
there's a lot of characters who capitalize on that kind of thing.
Yeah, so there's a nice, like, easy, it's simple enough to just get into and pick up and play the game, and you're like, wow, you know, this fundamentally is rewarding. You know, I know my fighting game principles, I can just kind of play it out and it's fun and jump around and go crazy.
Yeah, absolutely.
And then, two, a lot of the characters you'll play will have some crazy cheap stuff you'll find. And you'll just abuse that as much as possible. It'll be fun.
Most of them will. And with, like, a character with, like, over, or a game with over 90 characters, there's going to be some character that you don't know the matchup for. They're going to do some weird stuff that you didn't know was plus. And you're going to mash on it, and you're going to eat, like, 5K. So.
They'll just get jump scared by stuff. It's like, what? They can do that? All right.
And F-Arc, like you said, does a lot of damage, has a lot of plus frames with that wave that she throws out.
Yep.
So we'll have to see Alex try to do that, but right now he's stuck in the corner.
Yeah, they get the mash out, and then also F-Arc, you know, if you dash at someone, you can get that cross-up, but afterwards Phoebe getting the mash out.
Yep, and here we're going to see Phoebe go for some degenerate mix-ups. Yep.
Oh my gosh.
So that's like a four-way pretty much, and she can do it off of like any starter, so...
Oh, guess wrong again.
One good thing about Arc, though, in this matchup is that Arc has a 2-2C reversal. So no matter what side Phoebe is going to be on, if you do your reversal and she's not ready for it, then it could actually flip her no matter which side she tries to go on.
Yeah, that's very huge in this matchup. Yeah, being able to hit that 2-2 and just boop, no matter what direction they pick. You know, if you're willing to DP and try, or, you know, take the gamble while you're going in. And Melty Blood's about gambling, so let's go.
That was a typical Sasuke round, so... We're going to look to see Alex try to come back off of that.
Yeah.
Nice little dive kick there. No real openings this match yet.
Yeah, Mike Alex getting a lot of these straight hits in neutral, but Phoebe's never in a spot where if the hit lands, it's very devastating. Whereas this, you know, this starter in the corner, it's time for the mixie again.
All right, I know Alex. He's going to 2TC here. Watch this. Yep.
Enough of this. No more holding the mix. Just let me out.
Yep. And then this is where Alex shines, actually. Once this character gets you in the corner, the strike throw game is very real, and wave and 2B are very, very strong in the corner specifically.
I've never seen that move whiff before. That was crazy.
The move's actually, like, it's very good. It does have some spots where it'll whiff, and it's not invincible. So if you're close enough and you have a button coming out, this could kill. No, drops a combo, and that means that Alex is going to take round two.
Yeah, a few unfortunate drops back and forth and scrambles for getting back into it, but yeah, Alex taking the round.
Okay, we'll see who gets the first opening here, the first real opening. Let's feel each other out.
Yeah, there's a common string Alex is doing that they're ending in, I think some, it's like 2C or some long special, and it hits Phoebe trying to jump out, but there's no follow-up afterwards, so it's not threatening too much.
Yeah, exactly. But Arc is, like, very good in the neutral game, though, so, that shield was really good, but unfortunately I have to shield multiple hits to be able to counter that.
Oh, huge air. Back in the corner for big pressure.
Yeah, Alex is very, very good at sniping jump outs. Oh, catches her pressing a button. Let's see if he can finish the game. No, he misses the one frame link.
Yeah, definitely hard to be able to come
into. What the hell was that? Okay.
All right, Phoebe getting some life back. Stopping the timer. Alex trying to be very careful. He doesn't want to just run into anything. You know, Phoebe gets a hit with being that
heat. It's
a huge
game.
Combo.
Oh,
yeah.
Run to take the corner back for some reason. Gets the knockdown. Wave does not jump out. Good patience, but excellent capitalizing on the life lead there. Finishing it.
Yeah, it feels like for a lot of times they're neutral going back and forth. Alex seems to have the advantage, right? Like a lot of those little hits just kind of slowly add up until Alex can push Phoebe to the corner. But when Phoebe gets that one hit from anywhere, it's like this giant, the mixes start.
Yep. Alex again gets the opening, and now Phoebe is in the corner. So
that was so much damage. I feel like I blinked and afterlife's gone.
Yeah, Arc does a lot of damage for such a simple combo, too.
You can feint the arms. Oh my gosh, Satsuki's crazy.
Yep, it's actually really nice to catch jump outs, too, because then you can do her air special that snatches out of the air. But
yeah.
Alex with a pretty convincing round here. Let's see if he can take.
Really, just a couple openings all that was needed there, and the arc combos with the rest. Whoa! The counterplay!
Alright, this is Phoebe's chance to really get some damage.
Oh, they get that first hit off the fade back, but doesn't confirm, but gets a follow-up.
This is Phoebe. It's alright, though, because she's still cooking this one. Yeah, you can whiff, cancel the overhead swing into the
so. Yeah, felt like Alex getting hit a lot in pressure. Phoebe was doing maybe like jab or just trying a few hits and maybe going to that command throw or anything else. And then Alex, you know, getting caught out trying to jump out and not get caught by any command grabs. Yeah, Alex seems a lot more comfortable now to start just taking it slow and waiting for the time to escape. But the overhead, surprise, overhead jump scare.
Yeah, and that move is like, not only is it kind of hard to block if you're not paying attention, but you can immediately half charge it and cancel it into her 5 frame.
Oh my
really
gosh. Yeah, that's huge.
This is going to pull him out of the corner.
Oh.
It's the 2-2s.
This should be dead, right?
It'll be pretty close. She can dump another 100 meter.
Yeah, right there. Oh, finally saved my channel points. I feel like every time I've been on commentary this weekend, it's just like I lose all of those. I never call them. I'm like, ah, oh, there they go again.
Very, very pivotal game two.
Yeah. Always like seeing players stop after a win or a loss and just sipping water, sitting there and waiting and thinking. I know every set I play, I think I should do that, and then I'm like, nah, put me back in.
Go right back in. Yeah, Alex is very, very good at taking his time getting back into the end of games. Even if he like wins, he'll do it too. So.
Yeah.
Unless he's very, very confident.
Yep. You know, Alex very good at a lot of different games, so it's just one of those things that's more very fundamental to the nature of competition as opposed to even fighting games, right? Like, okay, cool, we can take a minute to think in between, get my mind sorted out. Big wave, huge starter.
Yeah, look at that damage off. It's such a little combo. He's already at half health. Nice! Doesn't get the connection there.
Yep, very scary pressure. Always trying to cover the jump out. You know, it's always bad feeling when you're playing strike, then your opponent jumps out the corner. And eventually, Alex catches Phoebe trying to get out. Still alive. Whoa.
Yep, so that's not actually like a real reversal, so you can trade with that. But it is very good at like getting out. That's because it comes out.
Oh my gosh. That jab is crazy.
Okay, just to keep it safe. This is where he shines. Strike throw plus game. Got yeah.
Just slowly ticking down, and every time you try to choose the option that doesn't get you thrown, if they instead choose to strike, you're taking like 5k because F-Arc does so much damage. You just perish instantly.
Taking the throw against F-Arc is typically better, but you don't want to eat so much damage. It's going to be close, not quite. Wave initiative.
Whoa, he. Yeah, the timer is turbo stopped.
Oh, that would have worked too if she was just a little bit closer. Oh my gosh, Alex is.
Yeah, you know, just one solid hit away from taking the set. Oh my gosh.
That 5A I was telling you about. That's super fast. It's incredibly good anti-air in a game that notoriously doesn't have great anti-airs. Oh, it's the same side mix up.
There might only be one more guest left until Alex is dead.
Shouldn't pull out of the corner, but she
oh,
drops,
wow.
And it doesn't matter.
Safe drop.
The scramble.
Oh, yeah, with meter spend, this should take it. Oh, you don't even need the meter. Dang, Sasuke's still going.
Now, you can argue she might have wanted to spend the meter there, but Seema kind of like.
Oh my gosh. There it is, there it is.
First time it lands.
I think I heard Zippo yelling in the background that moves cheap.
Yeah, Alex tries to jump out, gets.
Whoa, back dash.
There we go.
I'm not getting command grab.
So
oh, but getting a reversal.
Yeah, gets a combo.
What the heck?
And this is gonna pull Alex out of the corner too.
3.7.
Nice
oh, he just backdashes out.
He knew which way. He's got so much meter too. If he can get to 100, he can get some life back. There it is.
Wow, that just barely whiffed.
All right, he's gonna wave initiative. If you watch this.
The mash!
Oh my gosh, I can't do that. Mash part
burst out. He?
That is a beautiful heat. Look how much life she is getting back.
Oh my gosh. Very good, very good. Neutral at the end there.
To lose the set, but congratulations to Phoebe making it to winner's finals.
I like, there's a lot of those pressure sections that Alex was just making absolutely sure, like, okay, you're not going to just jump straight out of this. Like, I'm going to smack here, I'm going to go up. Like, you cannot, you have to stay down, you know, do not jump out. And eventually Phoebe, you know, kind of playing to that, was able to smack Alex somewhere else and then enter the preceding scrambles and got the neutral at the end there.
And both of those characters are very good in scramble situations. Phoebe comes up at the end. Just because of a missed meeting, too. That's how important that set, or that, you know, it came down to that missed meeting at the very end. So.
Yep.
Now we have Zapoke versus Aces High. This matchup actually happens quite a bit. Anytime there's, like, somewhat of a big current code tournament in Ohio, these two typically meet. So I think the last time they played, Aces High took it, but it was close. And I know Zapoke has won a tournament before over Aces High. So.
Yeah, it's definitely... Zapoke said, every time I'm at an event with Aces High, we have to play. Like, it's just how it is. And I know he also is, like... H. Como, cheap. That champion's cheap. You know, I don't know about that guy, but that's just how it goes.
H. Como is actually notoriously one of the least cheap characters in current code.
I swear I've heard him call it cheap before. Maybe he was joking, but I would not be joking. All these champions, I know you're hiding something that's cheap.
Koma,
I know it's there.
Is hard to play against, admittedly, but H. Como doesn't have a whole lot going for him, but one thing that he does really have going for him is his pressure, because H. Moon has the auto combo series, so that is very, very good in H. Koma's pressure, and obviously all those repeats. I feel like H. Koma is, like, maybe a little bit faster than C. Koma on the ground, the run speed, and there's a lot of tech trap options that H. Koma has, and a lot of, like, repeat pressure that you'll see Aces High do, as they say.
Yeah. I know, importantly, F-Aura has the air command dash, which I know for a fact is cheap. F-Aura, that character's crazy. Jumping over the screen, doing the
very,
mixes.
Very hard to hit. But yeah. I will say, H-Koma does have a solid anti-air. Like I said, in a game that doesn't have too many good anti-airs, I'm pretty sure H-Koma has one of the best with his 2D. We'll see if Aces High can catch on to Zapoke's air habits and hit him with a double
sneeze. Yeah, right.
That Warafia has, and now we get, like, the Eno from
Guilty Gear. Oh my gosh, the land shield!
That's a good shield. I just have heat, so he will burst out of that. Yeah, that's
punish. Oh my gosh, he doesn't get the punish, he drops it.
Alright, here's where H. Koma shines in the corner. He doesn't get a whole lot of damage per hit, but if you add all those hits up, then that's the rank, so.
Yeah, it seems like there's a lot of space that Aces High has a really hard time being able to get into, right? With Zapoke being able to do that 63, that big, I don't know if the input 63, but the big wheel, right? The anti-air.
Yeah, he uses the wreck. Oh no, he drops the combo though. This is still anyone's game.
Oh, big kick. Taking him out.
Yeah, it's funny that this is an Ohio classic with Zapoke lives in Michigan. So Zapoke is actually awesome for traveling out to all these events in Ohio that we have for current code.
Yeah, Ace High doing the same shield there to be able to get out. Not wanting to stand in the static or hold any mixy that F-War might be doing to him.
Zapoke is not shy about throwing out all of these weird air options that are punishable, and then he'll throw out, like, another kind of DP move to hit if he thinks he's gonna get punished.
Yeah. It seems like it's frequently really hard to punish those from Aura. Like, when Aura does that DP and just lands, if your character doesn't have something that immediately hits that space, it's super hard to punish, it seems. At least I've noticed a lot of people miss it over time, but yeah, it's definitely like, alright, there they go. There they go, do another reversal.
Alright, yeah, that was a good block on the FD mode there. Yeah, see, something like that is just kind of hard to deal with sometimes.
Yeah, the few times that Aces High has instead, you know, been able to block that standing on the ground, there hasn't been close enough to be able to punish. So it's very low risk to Zapoke to just throw that out, and if one of the ticks smack Aces High, he just dies.
This is where it starts for this character. It's a little bit of his health back, adds a little bit of damage. Maybe look to see Zapoke peek here. He mashes out instead.
He mashed out. I was just about to say, Aces High has been consistently just doing very standard, like, solid Oki, meeting him, and just hitting Zapoke, and then finally, Aces High stops doing a meaty, or maybe he mistimed or something else happens, and Zapoke's still mashing out, and then he wins the round.
Yeah, it's actually pretty smart from Sapoke because a lot of people would expect to be in that situation, so using dash to get out is very smart. Nice punish on the first shield.
No, Acei doing a really good job of being able to get it there, or get in there, and be very close to the poke, where he's no longer at the range where he would want to do the giant spin to cover off the sky. Oh my gosh!
Empty jump. Wrap it up. Game one, going to the Aces
high. Yeah, you know, watching it, H-Koma, he's not that cheap. He's just like a normal character. I don't know.
He's honestly kind of like a pretty honest character.
He might be the most honest character I've seen in this game.
Yeah, most of the honest characters you don't actually see.
Yeah, true, very true.
But he makes it work though. He's very good with this character.
Yeah, a lot of it too, when you want to think about risk reward for having that DP anti air hit. It's like, if it hits, it isn't just doing 1500, because you also have the follow up guessy game that you have to deal with. So there's a lot of like threat from that, whereas, you know, if it gets blocked, a lot of times the poke just gets away.
Check out this corner pressure.
Yeah, it was very solid for a while. You know, Acei not trying to make too many gambles or give Sapoke too many opportunities to mash out, but...
He tries to use the armor on Rekka to get out of the corner as often, and Sapoke is doing a very, very good job at using some multi-hitting moves.
Oh, is he going to kill off this? Does this have bad enough scaling? Okay,
nope.
Okay.
Oh,
wow!
Sandori mix-up.
Yeah, that was very good.
Yeah, so if you think H-Koma is going to kill, likely that character's not going to kill. He does very, very little damage from his combos, unless it gets like a big counter hit or something.
Yeah, a lot of his full screens, a poke, not immediately throwing out neutral options that are very committal, just kind of, you know, jumping around hoping that the Acei overcommits, and Acei doing the same thing back as a poke, you know, you just kind of wait and feel it out. But eventually, oh my gosh.
Oh, he uses the dodge function that is not used very often in this game. But it's kind of nice for H-Moon, because H-Moon doesn't have a whole lot of defense.
Yeah, I've seen him do that a dozen times. Every time.
He doesn't have any meter, though, so this is pretty
he
dangerous.
He woke up and did stand shield. He's crazy.
Yep,
oh,
cross up
in the corner.
Drops the combo. He's got a good deal of meter on him.
Oh.
This was empty turn low. Sapoke doesn't fall for it. Let's see if he arc drives here to finish. But he doesn't capitalize.
But he gets out afterwards.
Nice shield. Okay, the Rekka does not catch him. Yeah, if you air block that punish? Okay, beautiful. That was a good job to wait.
Yeah, and just throws. Yep. Very solid from Aces High. Very, very solid. It seemed like a lot of times the stuff the Poke might have tried to do, like the DPs or the continued, you know, like doubling down, Acei was eventually able to just kind of block more of it out and not get mixed up too hard and able to just stay sturdy and know, okay, I can block a lot more, I can wait and get some more interactions, I won't get blown up that fast. You know, I have time to wait and pick my battles.
I definitely feel like he knows the Poke enough to know that the Poke's going to throw out those invincible meter reversals after he does something unsafe like that. So
yeah.
He did a really good job playing patient and taking advantage. Alright, next up we have Vyasuius, formerly Unlucky,
yep,
versus Ocean. Ocean, another YAG Gacha member, so there's three matches in a row we've had for the YAG. Actually, we're going to have four, too. The next one has one as well.
Yep, it's YIG all the way down the line here, it seems.
Yep, Ohio is YIG territory.
Yep.
We've had some invaders.
There's a chance if Vyas wins this match, the next match in losers would be Vyas Sapoke, and that would be two people who don't have the YIG tag. But other than that, it's like unavoidable, I think.
Yeah.
Every other match has to be a YIG member.
Yep.
So YIG coming in strong for Code Current.
Yeah, and Ocean actually also plays F4Akia. So he did initially play C-Nekomek, decided that the character kind of wasn't doing him too many favors. Character's still cheap, but not F4 cheap, so...
You know, in the like hierarchy, right? You're either satisfied with how cheap your character is, or you're like, I gotta get more cheap. And see, Nekomek was not cheap enough for him, so he had to keep going.
Yeah, but he likes the funny characters too, and F4, you know, makes everyone laugh. And then Vyasuius plays F-Arc.
Yeah, at Whenever I play them at Toledo, usually they just cycle between all three arcs. So I don't know if they're always playing F arc in bracket specifically, or if they just it's how it is in casuals. But I know they can play all three pretty well because I've gotten the beatings from the arc. So
gotcha. Yeah, we do see F arc coming out on the band stage. The band stage, because the grass obscures some things. So.
Oh, like narrows out there or something.
Yeah, exactly. Actually.
Mix. All right.
Ocean doesn't have any like super crazy combos, but he's very, very good at these. Gets the hard knockdown. Let's see if he sets the pillar.
Yeah, does the 2-2, gets out.
Yeah, okay, running out to fight.
Yeah, I put a block bang in a little bit of a turn started, but Ocean can push out enough to go back to neutral.
Whew. That's actually kind of a hard thing to combo after that chain. Closing out round one, pretty oppressive.
Yeah, definitely so far feels like a lot of stray hits, and every now and then Ocean gets some of the mix going. But this was a solid combo from Ocean.
Yep, Bias does get an open, unfortunately does not capitalize on it. I know that Bias is very, very good at doing large combos as well. Like, they've definitely got the one frame fixed now.
Yeah, Bias, I've seen a lot of the clips Bias has posted about, like, oh, look at this new rap arc that I can do, or it's very impressive.
I definitely left Ocean.
Oh my gosh!
They were just about to take the first round, but now Ocean is kind of looking to...
Ocean's got less than a pixel left. Oh, yeah. Smack him out of the skies. No more jumping, no more guessies. Get out of there.
Mark has very good round blocks.
Yep, the command dash coming in overhead.
Other side. We're going to be trying to see Bias and see if they can dash here in some of these situations. If you do the cross up and then re-jump with the command that Boracia has, you can kind of mash out of it. It's not always super safe.
Yeah, off of the regular, let's say, like, more standard B&B and afterwards trying to do the air command dash mix-up, are you able to land fast enough to block if they decide to DP, or is DPing usually like, okay, they're high enough, I can just wreck it? You gotta, like,
judge. Yeah, you can safe jump with it.
Okay. Yeah. So, oof, that's very stressful then. It's not just like, oh, you see they're high enough, hit it. Like, they can still land and not get hit.
Like a combo off of the fireball. Oh, that was really weird.
Yeah, odd that it only hit the one time, because then Bias able to recover fast enough to start smacking Ocean.
Bias was guessing on the Tekken ways, guesses it correctly, and now Ocean's out of the corner and getting some damage.
Oh, that Morgan dash doing so much work being able to get those JAs in. Very fast overheads.
And actually, Bias tried mashing there, but unfortunately did not work out. And guesses correctly.
Oof. Yeah, very solid pressure, but Ocean able to hold up and get out of it, and then land and punish.
Alright, Ocean on set point right now.
A lot of meter for Ocean as well, almost at 300, right? The second you get there, you're forced to switch over.
If you notice, he actually tried to spend meter at the end of the round, which is very important for Ember. Because if you go into max, you can try to spend it there too before you might be max. Because if you go into max mode, and after max mode, you go down to 100 meter, so you want to use that meter.
Yeah, and through all this, Ocean just been running the mix gauntlet on Bias, and that's been super tough to deal with.
Good stuff to Bias, though, getting 7th place.
Yeah, they definitely had very, very strong rounds, very solid pressure. So, But, the F-Aura, it's just... You can only block for so long against F-Aura before the mix starts to just overwhelm you, right? There's too much, there's too much laughing, he's always doing, it's so... It's so hard to hold down.
And it's all a guess, too. You can't react to any of it, so... Can't be too upset when you get hit by it, because, well, I mean, what else are you supposed to do?
Yeah.
You just gotta try to beat him in neutral, and F-Aura is very good in neutral, so...
Yep.
It's up to Ocean advancing to fight against Zapoke, so that'll be a really fun match when that comes around. I expect
they're gonna be yelling.
There's gonna be a lot of jeering in the crowd. Oh. So we have a NPC joining me here on commentary.
Hello, hello.
Oh, that's the
Toledo Locals, it's a Limelight shirt.
The Limelight shirt. And we have the Cleveland. Cleveland. I live in Columbus, though, so it's, yeah. I'm from Neo, though. I'm from Northeast Ohio, but I live in Columbus now.
But you go to the Cleveland Locals, right?
I do, yeah. When I can, I try to make it up there.
Yig represent.
Yig represent. And we have
speaking of Yig, more Yig.
Slink, yep. Slink has been on that level up mode recently.
He's grinding with the FCL.
Oh, yeah. He's posting all the time in LFGNA. He's always trying to get games, and it's really paying off for him.
Yeah, definitely. Especially with a character as solid and well-rounded as FCL. You can see a lot of the work paying off, for sure.
Yeah, yeah. And that character has some really, really cool stuff and some really
honestly
overpowered things. she's underpowered in other facets, but she has some very, very strong tools in and in pressure. So.
Yeah. Tools like Flicker, you know, just being such a good burst option, plus on block.
Yep, Flicker, Charge 5C, has Clash Frames on it. It's actually a pretty good anti-air.
Right.
And it's a very, very damaging starter, so.
Yeah, I mean, she can hit over 6k with the optimals. You get counter hit starter.
Oh, yeah. Crazy stuff. Mel here on F-Hero. Mel notoriously doesn't like how difficult the combos on F-Hero are. But he's actually very, very good at neutral game with this character, and he really likes the tools that this character has. So he's been pushing himself to the limit. Congrats him for getting top 8, but right now he's kind of getting smoked.
Yeah, Slink off to a great start with a perfect here. I mean, Hamel plays zoners in all the F10 games, right? He plays Merkava, he likes sending the snakes out as he does with Nero here, and plays Vlav and Lumina as well. Nero definitely gets to play somewhat of a zoning game, but is a little bit difficult against CL's keys here.
Yes, Slink, like I said, FCL has very, very good tools in neutral to combat F-Nero.
Right, and wow, just teleporting right out of there. Slink left maybe a little bit of a gap with the EX key there.
Yeah, it's actually kind of hard to punish Slink.
Yeah, it definitely is. I'm sure, like, you need to be spaced out right for it.
Mel is struggling to get out of this pressure right now.
And wow, yeah, just double perfect from Slink here.
Yeah, let's see if he takes a moment to kind of reduce himself. No, he goes right back into
him. Just no hesitation, just jumping right back in. And now, even though we talked about Nero with the zoning, one of the things we're definitely going to see here also is CL can close the space a lot faster than Nero, so Mel's going to have to work really hard to get out of the way that Slink's just going to try and keep him suffocated here, as he's doing right now.
Yeah, Slink is very, very good at this point of pressure as well. Definitely. Setup, there's that charge beat 5C I was telling you about. It's got those flash frames on it.
Yep. Almost like aluminum, just clashing through something. Gets a starter and Slink closing out another strong round.
Yeah, Slink is putting in some
right. And these two actually fought in Undernight as well earlier this weekend, so definitely no stranger to fighting each other.
Oh, but yeah, Mel comes up to Yugo's too sometimes. So.
Right. But Slink just looking a lot more comfortable and in control here. Hamel has had a lot of trouble getting out of this corner, but manages to jump out this time.
Yeah, and Nero actually doesn't really have the most natural buttons sometimes either, so.
Right.
That's another kind of issue with natural buttons.
Yeah, Nero known for having a lot of reach, but not always the fastest with those long buttons.
Right. Oh, gets
combo. Yeah, just getting caught on wake up and Slink with a very fast 2-0.
Yeah, very, very quickly, but congrats to Mel for making top 8. That's right. A big dub.
Representing the Toledo Locals.
And then Slink moves on to fight Mecha Alex, which that matchup has happened more times than I can count. So.
I mean, it's a Yig classic, right? There's so much Yig representation in the bracket.
It is a Yig classic. And the funny thing is, too, it's been getting closer and closer every single time. Yeah. So Alex used to be pretty dominating when they played, and now Slink has gotten way, way better, and he's kind of going 50-50 with Alex when it comes to playing in casuals and stuff. So.
Dang, that's pretty impressive. I know Mecha Alex is usually top threes most of the Yig events.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, he's definitely our second, third best player here in Ohio.
Right. But good stuff to Slink with another strong win, and I believe we're moving on to winners finals now with Phoebe against Aces High, Seasasi against Hkoma.
Yep, and actually one notable thing in this matchup too, I'm not sure if Phoebe delays her 63 charge A normally, but you have to do that on Hkoma.
Interesting.
Because if not, you'll get the normal command grab instead of, you know how she does like the punch up and
punches
for a combo. So, yeah, she loses out on a lot of damage if you can't consistently get that delay and that combo against Hkoma and Respite.
Interesting. Well, I did see Phoebe playing some casuals against Hkoma earlier, and we were talking about this just earlier today, where she was saying even though she hasn't been upkeeping the game and like entering brackets as much, like just so many hours on Satsuki, the combos are engraved into her bones.
And she was like one of those really fast like up and comers as well. I remember when she was first starting out. And she got really good, really fast, and it seems like she hasn't really been playing as much anymore.
Right.
But she's sitting in winner's finals. So pretty
Definitely.
Good stuff.
And good stuff in other games this weekend, too. She got second in Vampire Savior yesterday, actually, too.
Yeah, she got top 8 in the next one as well.
Yeah, and wow, a really strong start here, just yoinking Aiden out of the sky here.
This is his air throw ender.
Unfortunate drop with the moon shoes.
Sasuke kind of has like a plethora of meter to reversal options, and Hkoma is very, very good at keeping his partner in the corner, so we'll have to see how those interact.
Absolutely, and fuzzy jumping to escape the super here.
Yeah, very, very good. It doesn't normally throw out that last arc too often. So.
Alright, but you know what, you've got H-Man Heat, you can cash out, your opponent's like respecting your pressure a lot, right?
Does have the delays, but unfortunately drops the meter.
Yeah, Aiden's sneaking out there with the shield here.
Back in the corner! Oh, the hard bait on the heat as well.
That should do it! Yep.
Yeah, it does attack. I think that's a tech trap anyway.
Yeah, it's kind of just checkmate at that point. So Aces High going up one round to start this.
I think I've heard that Aces High has had some kind of trouble on Sasuke. Sasuke kind of has like a little bit of a weirder body sometimes. Some
yeah, Sasuke can be a little bit hard to combo sometimes, but it's I just sneak into there with the Hkoma 2B again to get the end here.
Yeah, 2B is actually pretty good against Sasuke overall because she only has one air option when she leaves the ground.
Right.
So if she chooses to do an early JA, then she's coming down and she has no other button she can press.
And, you know, the Hkoma 2B definitely a little bit of a notorious end here. Baits the bunker, but not a full punish. Aiden's been so good at just backdashing out of the pressure, not really letting Phoebe get started with any offense here.
Yeah, if there's one thing Hkoma is good at, I guess there's actually two things. His movement and his corner pressure are both very, very good.
Definitely, and Aiden's so good at making the pressure so scary by Hkoma here.
And he's pretty patient too for someone like a Hkoma who's got a lot of movement. He's very, very good at playing patiently in a game where...
Yeah, as we saw with the hard heat bait right at the end of last round, just backdash and wait. Give just enough space and then punish.
Dropping the enders off the combos. And that's where most of Sasuke's damage comes from, is from when she gets that knockdown and she can run
themselves. Right, but I've just been so in control of this set. The counter hit on wake up looked like maybe Phoebe went for a reversal option here.
Yep.
And heating through the super. Some of that life back.
Not gonna have any meter though when she is out of that heat.
Yeah, did get some life back, but didn't really get any touches to shorten the lead that Aiden has already.
Tries to push out. Not
quite enough. One more chance for this round.
Plus.
He's been so good at mixing in that kick there just to stop the jump out. And really scare Phoebe into just staying down in that corner.
Yeah, that kick is very, very strong. It's a plus. And if you try jumping and get hit by it, you can react and air throw to keep the pressure going.
Yep.
There's a nice curve off that counter here.
Yeah, and the full combo.
So he tries going for the arc drive again. It hasn't worked twice.
We'll have to see. It definitely has the bar to burn and just holds on to it. Keeps up the tight pressure and catches Phoebe trying to move out with a slight delay there.
That backdash was so blatant. This is high up 2 games to 9 over Phoebe in our winner's final.
And dashing right back in to punish the mash there. This has just been entirely in control of the set so far. Going back to character select. I doubt we'll see a swap here, but it looks like maybe a moment to think before heading back in.
I know Phoebe originally did play F-Satsuki.
Oh, yeah, she did mention playing a little bit of that character. I'm not sure if the one frame link character is the one you want to swap to when you haven't been entering as much, but we'll see.
There's a couple of benefits for picking Ethmoon and Satsuki, but for the most part, C is pretty definitively the better character.
Oh, the H, perhaps?
H is actually very, very strong.
Definitely. But going back to the tried and true C Satsuki here, hoping to bring this back, she's going to need a reverse 3-0.
I feel like H Satsuki might have been better against kind of like that 2P that Aces High has available to him, but otherwise, C pretty much has everything you need in a character. So.
Definitely. I mean, even if the JBE could potentially threaten their Colma, 2B just hasn't really had the opportunity to get started very much, right?
Yeah.
Aces High has been so good at just staying right out of the range that Phoebe wants to be in, maintaining control, and as we see right there.
This mashup did confirm on the outward.
Satsuki came all another unfortunate drop here.
Yeah, that 2C is very, very finicky.
Indeed.
As we can see twice in the middle.
Yeah.
So you can choose to dump there. Oh, he went for the R drive setup, but I guess he like flubbed it.
Just get him out of there with the X.
He has been wrecking a lot in neutral.
And the Wild just catching a quick command grab, catching like a.
I feel like if you're up in this set like this, you really want to keep the pace going, so why not just keep doing some crazy stuff like throwing rockets out of control?
Yeah, and you know, that was one of the first command grabs we've seen for this whole set, so I might have even been the first. Shit! The overhead!
Reacted to the flash with the shield.
Yep. The armor coming
that
through,
very,
the trades.
Very good at trading.
Command grabbing the shield, yeah, Aces High just establishing so much fear here. Now with the threat of command grab, the X record drops. Doesn't really matter at this point. Baits the heat again with the backdash, and that should be it.
Doesn't
yep.
Attack, gets hit with a 2C. Good stuff, Aces High. That was a very convincing winner's final.
Definitely just ran all the way with that one with the fast 3-0.
And Phoebe, of course, still in it. It's going to be firmly in loser's final.
Right.
Waiting on a couple of matches that we're going to have up until there.
And Aces High also, you know, another one of the egg players who's been on the grind a lot, wins
yeah,
a lot of your events.
It never stops for him. He's always hosting up or asking for hosts. And,
yeah.
You know, he got top 8 at the last climax of night, which
true.
Is very, very good. And he's like a really good Dengeki player, too. He got top 8 at Dengeki at the last climax
oh, wow.
as well. So.
Did not know that.
He can stick to a game and grind it pretty good. He's been on the Street Fighter grind. He got top 24 in
right.
that as well here.
Yeah, with the Marisa pick, I believe, too. She waits for Rashid.
Yep, and he got 9th at Crossover Arc and Lumina as well. So he's just a very talented fighting game player.
Yeah, definitely. And, you know, with so much Yig waiting on the other side of bracket, potentially coming back up to meet him, or is the poke as well, people, he's more than accustomed to fighting, right?
Oh, yeah.
It's going to be interesting to see how Grand Finals ends up playing out with whoever makes it back up there. But
and
for
here
now.
We have the funniest match of top 8.
Potentially F. Waramir's between Zepoke and Ocean.
It has to be F. Waramir's.
Yeah, I wouldn't be surprised.
If Zepoke chickens out, then.
But, you know, maybe a little known fact, Zepoke has been playing a little bit of C-Neco mech the last few days, apparently.
That is so funny. I heard that too yesterday, and I could not believe it.
We could see a C-Neco mech mirror.
There's no way. Ocean is... I feel like Ocean is kind of just done with that character. I've seen him
probably
pick it a couple times in bracket, but he's done with that character.
Yeah, it's been like all F-Wara for the whole weekend, but Sepulk, I mean, notorious F-Wara, really strong showing at Combo Breaker recently, too, and making top 6 on winner's side at that event.
And they both kind of play similarly, too, which is really funny. Like, they both... I mean, obviously, if you play F-Wara, you're a psycho, but they both, like... They both act like it, definitely, when they play.
Yeah,
so.
I mean, they're just funny guys. Like, you talk to them outside
that's
the game,
true.
And they're just screwing around.
They're
and translates exactly to how the character plays out in this game.
They both love their funny characters.
They really do. FYF. The F stands for funny.
And actually, I'm not sure. I know that they've played the FOR mirror before in bracket, but I do not remember who won.
Might have been at an isolated incident, would be my guess.
Yeah, or it could have been at What a Horrible Night to Lose a Burst as well, or even Something True. Sweet in Toledo. But they've played each other before, I know that.
They definitely have, but you know, Zapelka's been on the character for a longer time. We'll see if that experience shows anything different in this matchup, or if maybe one of them picks a different character and decides to not play the mirror. Zapelka also has a Suara, so.
And who knows? I mean, there's probably not that many Fuara players, so how often does Zapelka play the mirror? So they could be on equal footing when it comes to that as well.
That's true. I mean, there have been a couple. Sen was playing the character for a while. Red also plays FYR, so.
Oh, yeah. I've played against Sen's FYR on that. Yeah, same. It's the least fun experience I've ever had in Melty Blood.
Same, I feel that. Last time I fought Sen, it was his H3, so that was a rough one.
I've played against his C-Roa as well.
Definitely
F-Nero.
Crazy characters to fight. But we'll see what shenanigans we get coming up. I feel like maybe could be some technical issues.
Yeah, maybe. That's just how it is with Caster. Right. Sometimes it works. Sometimes it doesn't.
We've actually did pull out some of the laptop setups the community brought for bracket, as we ran into some technical issues with the PCs that they have for the other games here, just controller issues and whatnot, but yep. Make it work.
But I really appreciate the TOs here at Cap City Chaos for having all their own PCs and coming with preloaded Caster on there and everything for us to try out and use. So
yeah, definitely.
Even if it didn't always pan out for the best, it's still really appreciate the TOs putting forth that effort.
Right. And I mean, as you said, Caster being loaded on all the machines, we got to pull extra machines for bracket that weren't originally on the pod that we had for that, but they just have Caster on so many setups, so we were able to use extras. So shout outs to the Cap City TOs again.
Yep. Ohio TOs represent.
And for giving this game a stream. It's been cool to see like a lot of different games represented in the streams this weekend, too.
Yeah, it's not even always really easy to stream this game, either.
They're, true.
With some of the technical issues that could come up with PCs and tournaments.
Yeah. And also some of the issues that can come up with a stream setup. I know there's been a lot of issues throughout the year of some laggy stream setups time.
It feels like everything's been really, really smooth here. So
definitely.
Cap City Chaos, hopefully it's back next year.
Hopefully.
It's even bigger next year. We got the Popcorn Baron here.
True. And even just being in Columbus, we're right by some great places to eat.
Oh, yeah. The North Market.
North Market has been great. Literally across the street. Absolutely. Yeah. Went there like three times.
Earlier today. So.
Oh, and it looks like we are seeing the Sea Necromech
from
Ocean here. Not wanting to play the mirror.
Ocean is a scrub.
We'll have to see in this poke. Already setting up a fort with the fireballs. Blood Ocean sneaking in there with the cat.
Yep, hard knockdown on the blazer.
Spoke might have been playing this character, but was saying he's been playing the character because he thinks they're cheap. So we'll see how ready he is for what Ocean's got.
Yep, that move is kind of hard to deal with that reversal. It's got a flash frame on the first frame, so you kind of have to know what to do to do it.
Yep. Also have to know what to do against that cat as it comes down and counters.
Oh, and he gets a single hit of the cat laser too, which is
Poke already down a lot of life here, and
Ocean, whenever he has max, he is going to art drive.
But you already have a huge life lead, and if you preserve that, he comes into this 200 bar.
Oh, the big counter punch!
It's gonna be good damage.
Does it again? Oh, okay.
Yeah, not biting on the EX DP this time. That's just a poke class, like, just DP, XCP.
Chainsaw whiffs, comes down with a 2A, you're getting started.
Poke putting Ocean in the corner, and there it is. Even if you play the character, it's hard to not get hit by the FWAR mix sometimes.
Oh, he messes up the arc drive.
And the guard crush, just barely catching him before he lands. So poke just backdashing out of there. Cat whiff.
Yeah, you're playing, like, against a whole different character when you play this.
Right.
Just watching for that cat too. So
baiting the DP this time and does get the punish, but no full conversion.
Don't run into him.
As a poker respecting this cat a lot, and again with the classic. No punish. No punish.
There's
one more touch, and Sapo gets it.
Very, very, very close. Round
two. It's really tough to see which way this could go. It definitely looks like Ocean's aware of a lot of things Sapo could be doing, but Sapo getting caught by the Neko again. Respects
so,
the beam this time.
She doesn't do a whole lot of damage unless she lands an arc drive. That's where all of her big damage comes from.
Or potentially that counter hit charge C starter, but.
Supposed to be. Her job playing patient in neutral. He did run into the cat a lot in the first round, and now he's kind of figuring out neutral.
Yeah, it's rare to see Sapo so apprehensive, but just backing up so much around the cat has paid off a lot, as he was able to just get a lot of offense going in the corner there, off a few touches. And there's that arc drive, and Sapo just getting out of there, but the counter hit!
The one hit of Chainsaw is kind of crazy.
Yeah, the rare one hit for multi-hitting moves.
Pressure is very, tricky to escape if you're not familiar with it.
Yep.
And he's not, just about to say, he's not perfect guarding those hits.
Does get the little bit of a tap here though. Watching out for the cat. There it is. We saw that work out for Sapo a few times earlier, just going barely over the Neko to get the tap, and the haze is out! Fades the heat. Doesn't even need the haze to kill, and Sapo going up 1-0 to start.
Very, very close. First game. Ocean going right back into it, not even contemplating picking Aurora.
Right, just playing it out on the classic.
Taps the cat.
Well, you know, when you've been fighting someone who's been playing this character for as long as he has, Sapo knows a lot about the character. It may look like he's just clowning sometimes, but he knows so much about the FWARTA setups and their weaknesses as well. So, Ocean, I don't blame him for just sticking with the tried and true Neko mech.
We're gonna have to try to see how Ocean adjusts to the neutral game now that Sapo isn't just kind of running into the cat.
Right. Back into the haze. It fades away now, and just getting hit by the arc drive. And that's enough to kill.
Yeah, Sapo's doing a very, very good job of just running away. He doesn't need to go in when he's got the life lead.
Yeah, and this is such a rare Sapo to be watching. I don't think I've ever seen him play this way.
Yeah, he's playing really which is awesome. But he's also still a psycho.
As we see him dashing JA.
Ocean's probably gonna try to.
Oh, no defensive option. Again, just. Baiting the EX spinner, not biting. Missed the punish timing, unfortunately.
Sure, it's that can't be punished. Is it always punished?
It can, yeah, it's minus 10.
Okay.
The EX spinner is minus 10, but
maybe,
again, with the zero buffer on normals.
Doesn't have a great option to punish it, like a longer
right, it might really depend on the spacing. I know as a lane player, I do need to be spaced close enough to catch that with 3C, so it could be a similar case for her as well.
Yep.
There it is. Neko mech pressure. That strike throw situation is tough. The cat coming down, and there it is again. Not quite enough to kill, though. But that is.
Maybe he tried to reversal and messed it up.
Could be. That sounds about right, to be honest.
Wait, we're going to a third round here in a second.
Yep. And the counter hit chainsaw.
3200 is actually kind of big.
The X spinner! Ocean was pressing, but just very fortunately not in the right place to get hit. It looked like Wired did not turn around with that cancel, but.
That was a hard gamble.
Definitely a little bit of a suspicious choice, but manages to avoid more OP. Now, pretty good lead for Ocean. Sapo can have a lot to come back from, but it is FWARTA. One touch could be it.
Oh,
nah, going for the EXDP this time!
No!
Not quite enough to kill, okay. And that will be.
We saw a very, very cool interaction there where Ocean was expecting Sapo to throw out the reversal after landing.
Yeah.
And he didn't. And it was like, what the hell? You know?
Just one of those moments where they both went deer in headlights. The rare Sapo just doing DP. And maneuvering really close against that cat, baits out the reversal, but no punish.
It's hard to punish it if you block it.
Yep.
Whoa, the double shield!
I got mixed by all the sensors. I thought Ocean got hit.
I thought he did too. It's hard to see the static.
Right? And you're just hearing the hit sound effect from Neko getting caught.
So, you can actually kind of take advantage of Ocean's sometimes when you know he's going to hit the cat. So you
know he's doing the backwards hitting JC? That's why it was cheap. So Poke is also, you know, you mentioned that Ocean loves throwing out that arc driving. Notoriously one of the really strong arc drives in the game, but Poke has been so good at anticipating it and just not letting himself have to block it.
Yeah, he's doing a very good job at interrupting Ocean as well, because Ocean will jump up and charge his JC to come down and hit the cat, but you can just jump up and beat him in the air before the JC comes.
Yeah. This time the JV getting counter hit by the cat.
What is going on?
Kyle going crazy after seeing why JB get counter hit. And there it is, JB getting one with
him.
I think so. I feel like he just blocked the wrong side on that one, probably not sure which side he was gonna be on. But Ocean's turn to start running some corner pressure and the F4 shield counter! He definitely jumped expecting to get a combo off of that. But great reaction to the situation. Right? I mean, you hear the sound effect from Neko. It's a real mix.
He's got a lot of meter too, so one hit here could be some very dangerous territory.
Blocks the FLR mix the first time, but it's hard to block it more than once.
IH
from Zephoke?
Yeah, that's it. Yep.
There it is. FLR with the cheap mix-ups. Closing it out on Ocean.
Good stuff to Zephoke.
Yeah.
On Ocean getting fifth place, also pretty good.
And great stuff, even getting the one game off there, right, with Neko Mech. Good stuff.
Yeah,
he
does not play that character that much anymore, so...
Right, I mean, like I said, I've seen him only on the FWARA this whole weekend. He's been playing a lot of casuals with people, and he's been all WARA. But good stuff for Zepoke, advancing on the loser's side of bracket, and I believe we're going to get the other side of loser's side, which is going to be Mecha Alex and Slink.
This is probably the most played matchup in Ohio, if I'm being perfectly honest with you.
And it's funny because they play a canonical rivalry between
Ark
and Seattle.
That's actually true, too. They both play F Moon, which is pretty funny. Like, kind of like a lesser popular moon for those characters.
Same moon, Tsukihime rivals in the lore as Ark and Seattle.
I don't know about the lore of Tsukihime, okay? I just play Melty. I don't know the Tsukihime lore. I don't know the Melty lore. I know nothing about the Nasuverse. So. All I know is that... Arkoid does a lot of damage.
She does, but so does FCO!
That's also true.
Those flicker combos go crazy. Sapoke walking over here to ask if I have Sailor Moon. Bro finishes brackets and he's like, let me go play a different game before my next set. Like, chill.
He's a notorious shill of the Sailor Moon game. Ocean likes the game too, not surprising.
Right. But Zepoke is always up to something. You're still in bracket. What are you looking for? Speaking of bracket.
ADHD brain.
We are getting the character select music coming on. I'm sure we're going to see these characters, but Mecha Alex has been an FRX specialist for a long time. That definitely takes... commitment as well.
He has messed around with CR just a little bit.
Right.
Just because she's one of the best characters in the game, but he always comes back to FR.
Slink smiling as we get the Neko button check going on.
Then Slink was like cooking on H3 and decided that he kind of wanted to shop around for another character.
True. But honestly, I can't blame them. I mean, H3, you know, one of the weaknesses being H Moon defense, right?
Yeah, H Moon defense, combos dropping in tournament is also pretty rough to deal with.
Definitely.
It takes a toll on the psyche for sure. You know, someone who plays F Satsuki, when I drop a combo in tournament, it feels awful, so.
Yeah, definitely something that we're no stranger to seeing. And with, as we mentioned, some of the other stream setup mishaps that have happened throughout the year with the unfortunate circumstance that comes with having a tight link in your B&B, but. Here it is, the FCL that we were talking about. Just such a strong, well-rounded character.
And FCL does kind of have some harder stuff, like the double flicker combos.
He definitely does. Right. Yeah, mixing tier combos is something that I've heard a lot of people just complain about as being a tough thing to execute in combos, and it can be, especially in the game with as small a buffer as this one.
Yep, IEDs can be kind of funny in this game to do.
Right.
Like,
but as you said...
The Yig stage. Loser Cat Company, best stage in Melty Blood. It's the Gacha stage.
Yeah. We got Yig against Yig on the Yig stage with a Yig classic matchup.
Yeah, we got the Yig mascot, 20 of them in the background.
Cleveland in full effect on stream right now. Mecha Alex is getting right with the grab.
And like I said, this matchup has actually been pretty close as of recently. Slink has taken some tournament sets off Alex.
It's pretty impressive. And there it is, the counter hit flicker started. I'm impressed to hit. I did not realize it reached that far.
Oh yeah, that move is dangerous.
That move is ridiculous.
Oh! Okay, we're good. Good confirm. Mecha Alex.
Sharp scare off of Super Flash. And again, just a counter hit flicker. Mecha Alex probably also not expecting to still be in the space to get hit by that, but you gotta respect it.
Yep, and we're gonna look to see CCO kind of stay a little bit more spaced out most of the time.
A little bit of a scramble off the shield. Just barely, not enough!
Didn't go for the 2-2-C ender.
Mecha Alex just playing it safe, but the sneaky command grab.
Alex was afraid of doing anything. Right. Whoa! Okay, melty blood moment. Alright, we're gonna see a key here.
Yep, and just bunkering out.
Nice.
Great option. If Slink does choose to run up and hit a button, it's gonna be pretty reliable.
Bunker,
right.
He's gonna enter max mode.
Real close to it, and Slink just playing at the spacing, which is really hard for Mecha Alex to select, but does manage to find a way out the wave IH.
Megalix's
like own turn.
Loves that.
Faded shield counter. A little bit of a throw, but Megalix still has a bit of a ways to come back here. With throw is plus.
Yeah, exactly. Good for not mashing there. You would have gotten it.
Blocks the overhead. Gets out after the flicker this time. An even game.
Both these characters actually have pretty fast ground speed and are very good at running under other characters.
Yeah.
That clash was awesome.
The key's just catching Mecha Alex up in the DP! Barely missing! That should be enough.
Yep, these 2-2-C's to guarantee it. Doesn't want to mess up the combo.
Yeah, Slink taking game one there. And you know, you were saying this is probably one of the most played matchups in Yig as of late, and I feel like you can definitely see that in these players at the mid-range taking options that could seem high-risk, but it's probably coming from the fact that they've fought so much, right? And built up such an anticipation of what they might do.
Safe jump setup.
Yeah, Megalix just holding his ground in the corner, but gets tagged by the second hit of the key.
There's a good reaction there for Slink to follow up on.
Yep. Quick 4-2-1 to get out of there.
Yeah, let's see,
I believe it's 4-2-1. I don't know if I like that well.
Oh,
and gets tagged by the key again. It looks like maybe trying to jump out. Yeah, Mecha Alex probably thinking there's enough of a gap to get in there between the keys, but Slink just with the heads up play.
He's kind of run away with this set.
Yep. This time does hop over the keys, but not quite able to get the punish.
Okay, Alex is going to get something started in the corner. We have not seen Slink choose to reverse a lot of pressure yet.
Right. Art dive kicks. Wave hit, but no conversion.
He's not getting a whole lot of damage out of this
counter. Wake up, flicker!
Too good.
Yeah, it really is. I mean, just a giant hitbox at that space. What's Art gonna do? Maybe wave, I guess.
Slink's pressure has gotten so much better with this game.
Absolutely, and the key just tapping Mecha Alex again. I'm not really sure what's happening with that one.
Alex just backdash out of pressure twice. We'll see if Slink notices that. Kind of tries to do something.
Right. But Mecha Alex getting the counter hit as they fly at each other. Takes the life lead, and isn't he, and gets the tap after the shield counter bait. I don't think it'll be enough.
2-2-C, one to close that out. Oh, gets
a quick flicker.
That's like a tough thing to block.
Yep. And that's it.
That's like really tough to block when they do that, like half charge overhead into flicker, because
right.
It's like one of those situations where it's almost like a 50-50.
Yeah.
Because if you choose to stand block it and they flicker and you don't switch your block fast enough, you get caught, and then he gets that OTG pickup into the safe jump, and then it just restarts the pressure all over again.
Right. Yeah, it's just one of those things that even if you can kind of anticipate what's coming, you also have to physically time switching your block right to get that right. Just a tough situation, and you know, at the end of that set, just hearing one of them say, he knows. It's like, again, you know that these two have just fought each other so much, and even though it was a 2-0 and it looked like a pretty big one for Slink, like, there's just so many layers that build up in that set. Playing
I might
out the
be
way
wrong, but I'm pretty sure Zapoke and Slink played yesterday.
Yeah.
In bracket, and it was a 2-1.
Yes.
For Zapoke, but Slink taking that game off of Zapoke is
yeah.
a pretty big dub.
It's pretty huge. I mean, and Zapoke historically has won that. So again, like you said, Slink's been on the grind, and good stuff to them. They played three times this weekend because they also played an under night top 8 earlier.
Oh yeah.
They played
right.
to get into winners top 8 for this bracket, and now again.
So this is a rubber match actually because Slink won that one. So now this is their, you know, this is the best,
True.
Best two out of three of their overall matches.
The tiebreaker for the Cap
yeah,
City
the
weekend.
The Cap City Chaos rubber match.
True, and the Chaos Orioles too.
Yeah,
as the FR is out again.
Slink fighting himself. We all face the demon inside of us sometimes.
True. The demon that is FR.
The demon.
Yo, both sides. Yig Slink on the FR? Rare appearance. Locks the FR mix up. Hops over Flicker!
This is some insane neutral already.
Yep. And the single counter hit of JB. Just tagged by the meatball. No conversion. Forearm mix up.
By this pressure, does not choose to run under to take
the even on these wake-up situations, you can see Sapoke playing a lot more passive. Sapoke does have a lot of experience fighting CL, but they'll primarily see as he fights Armonte a lot. Probably trying to respect the CL reversals.
Yeah, true. Slink is not really going to throw out reversals a lot, I feel like Slink is pretty...
Definitely. But there we see one, and it whiffs on the meatball as... So Poke's able to close that out. Or I'm sorry, Yig Slink takes the round over Slink.
So yeah, the funny thing about that air EXP is you have to block it low.
Yep.
It's just kind of funny seeing someone get hit by it when they're like blocking high.
Right, and it does kind of make sense, like you see the shadows slide on the ground, right? But it can be sneaky if you don't know, and there's the reversal paying off this time after the shoot. The
yeah.
awkward hit of DP.
See if he can get the punish. Oh, he just chooses to charge by CQ.
Maybe thought it was a little bit more minus. Either that or expected Sapoke to mash after, perhaps. Sapoke?
He shielded the meatball to get into max kill. See if he can get some,
right.
some light back.
No guard break off the air blocked arch drive, but does get tagged hitting charge JC, or charge 5C, excuse me, from behind. And Sapoke just classic FYR.
Zapoke.
Right. I mean, Slink has been doing a good job of playing real solid. It just feels like Zapoke has had more control over the situation, also playing more solid, not overextending on his offense, and letting Slink kind of feel the pressure to make a mistake on defense.
And not only is FY like good in OP situations when he's running Zepway, but he's got fantastic control as well.
Yeah, it definitely does. I mean, Zapoke has gotten a lot of mileage off just flying around the screen here, setting up the meatballs sometimes. And here, just getting the quick air dash in. Back dash out. Definitely. I mean, back dash known to be a pretty strong option against Fwara, but Sapoke just with the variation of timing to catch it, and also slight dash in to catch that one for Slink in the corner, and Sapoke on set point.
This is only user semifinal, so this is Slink's last hope.
A single air counter hit of JB again. Baits out the DP, does not convert off the meatball hit though. Goes for the left right of the meatball.
That was like the slowest mix-up I've ever seen. Oh, that was a nice conversion actually. He didn't get the counter hit on the first one, so he had to react to it.
So poke shield countering full screen.
Yeah. It gets him a little bit of meter, right?
Right.
Why not?
Does trap Slink in the air, does not get the guard crush unfortunately because of the hover dash, but does manage to get the mix up. Goes for the empty low, and Zapoke with a pretty quick 2-0. Good stuff again to Slink, it's just hard to block that stuff.
Yeah, in fourth place Blaze is honestly very, very good at a tournament with all these good
players. Absolutely.
Ocean, Mecha Alex beating out those two players specifically to get top fours.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, Mecha Alex, again, usually gets as far as top three in the league events, so taking win over him to get this far, great stuff to Slink. And you know, like, it's interesting with these old games, too. You see the bracket numbers, not nearly as big as some of the big games that are out right now, right? But when you have a bracket this small, you also know the talent is going to be really dense, right? You're round one, you're already fighting someone who's really strong, maybe even in round one.
And honestly, for this event, Melty has a pretty good entrant number, too, because much as Lumina this tournament, I think.
More than.
Was it more?
Yeah, we had 25 to Lumina's 21, so.
To 21.
Yeah, big big showing for original Melty.
More than Marvel, which is the fourth highest game at Evo now.
True.
So I think this is the third highest. I think we had the same as Uni actually.
Right.
If I'm remembering correctly.
I think so. Maybe even slightly more. But I mean, shout out to Ohio for being one of the few scenes in the country to be running current code at locals. Toledo's got it at locals. You guys at YIG have it at the locals out there in Cleveland, right?
Yep, absolutely.
So. Good representation for the scene for this game here, and now we are moving on to losers finals between Phoebe and Zapoke. I don't even know if these two have played yet this weekend. It's got to be a long time since they fought each other.
Exactly, and it might have been before Phoebe really had her breakout too, and before Zapoke started playing F-Wara, because we know Zapoke was a C-Wara main for a long time.
Right, but Zapoke does have some recent wins with the F-Wara over Sofskis in brackets, so we're going to have to see if he's able to clutch this one out too and fight Aiden once again in grand finals, which would be another Midwest classic.
Right,
at this
and
point.
I don't know how I feel about this matchup coming from like as a Sasuke player when you have only one air attack option because the character's air movement is so good and has such big air buttons and fast.
Right.
That aspect can be kind of tough, but see, Sasuke also has that move.
Yup.
So,
notorious.
She's got 2C, which is a decent reversal option.
Yep. Text the air throw. And some poke, just comfortable dashing and dashing and dashing. Yep, Zapoke, I mean, content to just keep going as long as it's working. He's playing again pretty passive here with the Meepo on the EXDP at half screen.
Oh, he does it again. This time we see him.
Unfortunately, a little bit late. I feel like Zapoke did the first one, trying to bait that out to get the second.
And I feel like you had to 2C that, right? 2C is like 5 frames.
Yeah.
It's incredibly fast. It goes very far. So it should be a pretty good punish for that.
Definitely, you just gotta find the right timing, and with multi-hit moves, especially if you might not be fighting this character all the time recently, it could be a little bit tough to time.
Okay.
But Phoebe getting the full combo this time.
We saw Phoebe having a tough time comboing a combo, but Meraki is one of those characters that Sasuke can combo very, very easily, so that should be a problem for her.
Yep. Bates the shield counter, but the also notorious F-Wara shield counter. Wow! I'm not gonna lie, I was not expecting him to have a punish on deck.
Double overhead, blocks it.
Not that time though.
Try mash 5A,
Arc drive mix up and empty air to empty dash into dash again. And
both these characters are so brutal when they get ahead and they're knocked down.
They really are. You know, like, as you definitely know Satsuki player too, doing similar things to other people, but.
Oh, yeah.
F-Wara's got
like
the same game going.
Sasuke is like the best character on our game admins, so she dominates Japan.
Absolutely. Just going to use poke out the sky.
But that's actually not a bad option against F-Wara either, because, I mean, it's not like he can run on the ground, right?
Right, I mean, bound to having the hover dash, right? If the poke's got a move, it's going to be a really good option to try and catch that.
I will say, it is sometimes harder to do that against Wara, because Wara's buttons go so far, and, 63C is not a reversal.
Right.
So if you throw that out and there's a button on your head, then you
can get it. And as we see against the poke, that time a little bit too far out of the way.
Yep, the move is very, very good, but it's not perfect.
Yep. Spoke trying to make this comeback here. Opting to go for the meter charge. Unfortunately, it looked like a little bit of a stutter on the setup. But we're back here in neutral. Phoebe trying to go for the big grab to enter Zapoke.
Beautiful 5A. Let's see if she can convert this into
There it is. It's a poke just with the shield.
One thing you have to worry about is Satsang as well, against Wara specifically, is his box size, which is actually kind of bigger than his character.
Right. And baiting the reversal again. 2 seconds left on the clock, so Poke's just gotta run away, and there it is.
Wow, you almost never see two characters like this go on time.
Right? Characters? Wow, just the get to start off this round!
That was actually also a pretty good option against Waraku, because he's always there, so...
Definitely is. Very strong anti-air option.
Is Poke gonna be looking to play this far away neutral game, just hitting with the edge of JP and JC?
Yep, and PD baiting out the shield this time with the empty dash. Full corner conversion. What's the mix?
Out of the corner.
The slow left right.
Stand shield beats that 2A.
It does, unfortunately. Beats a lot of 2As, and Zapoke just reacting to the situation accordingly.
Yep, with Sasuke, a lot of times you want to go for 2C on her own, because stand shield beats 2As, 5As, so.
Right.
Hey, Phoebe taking her first round of the set.
A little bit of an OTG there, catching the tech.
Yep, Sasuke's OTGs are actually pretty deadly. If she gets like a random hit, she can turn an OTG into like 4k damage.
Definitely. So Poke maybe thought he had the meter for EX Spinner there. Spinner was so funny when it whiffs. Blocking the empty low. Just Poke with a little bit of a pickup.
Whiffs the high.
Counter hit. Looked like Phoebe had the right idea of trying to press on the hover dash, but...
That's so sad. It looked like he initially was trying to heat, and then she didn't heat, and then she did heat, and it worked out anyway.
Right. Just barely high enough. Sometimes the hover dash is so sneaky.
Oh, yeah.
You know, with those heats, not having the most vertical hitting hitbox all the time, right? The hover dash can sometimes be a sneaky way to catch it. Yeah, his FYR mix-ups has just been so strong, right? He's been varying between the empty lows, double overheads,
and
he's gonna have to adjust.
She could have gone for like another 2
as well. Right. It's Poke dropping as well, and he gets another chance to start offense. There's that deadly OTG you were talking about. Spoke not teching from a trade, but unfortunate drop.
Yeah, she goes for the harder combo where you do the charge 2C into another 2C. I feel like at this point, maybe, I might
want to
just try to go for the
1-2C. Maybe. Yeah, even life now, but Spoke burning the meter in archive. Drop again, goes for the air throw to catch the attack. A little bit mistimed. Spoke not biting on it.
Yeah, that scramble situation, she kind of bit it all on that.
Right.
It's a very fast move that she's been throwing at once in a while, and it hasn't worked out yet, but we'll see if she tries to get him on
it. Right.
A-pillar.
Just poke with the low, but no conversion. Just a raw 5B to catch the dash. It's one of those variations that we've seen from Zapoke that's not always common in his play, but has paid in dividends as he closes out the set with a perfect here.
Good stuff to Zapoke. Take that 3-0 over Phoebe, and congratulations for Phoebe for getting that top 3 finish. She's going to get a medal for current
code. And what a great place to finish for, you know, one of your first backets back to the game.
Yeah,
not exactly. Playing in a good while.
That's pretty awesome. She has not been very active recently. Decides to come back for this tournament, hang out with some friends, and gets third place. That sounds like a pretty good deal to me.
Yeah, definitely. And I mean, two top 3 finishes this weekend. Great stuff overall.
Yep.
And top 8 finishes
and
every
top
game.
Yeah.
But we are getting another Midwest Classic between Zapoke and Aiden, who have already played each other earlier today, and play each other basically every Midwest tonight.
Oh, yeah. Yep, there. I mean, they're two of the best players in the Midwest, so they always play against each other at some point in the bracket.
I know they've net played a lot. They definitely know this match, know the matchup from both sides really well.
There's no shortage of Waraku players in LFG NA.
That is true. And I mean, even if Aiden's the only H Coma really out there right now, they've just fought so much.
And I feel like H Coma's neutral is so different from CNF. Right. Whereas, like, maybe Afrakia's neutral kind of plays similarly to C. I mean, they don't have the same exact air movement, but at the same time, they both kind of are trying to do the same thing where they space you out with their long air normals.
Sure.
But yeah, Coma is, like, very different in that regard to the other Comas, so not a whole lot of experience the Poke probably has, unless he's playing against Aiden, of course.
It is true, but I mean, Poke's also fought Joggalot, and even if the Comas are two different moons, right, there's still some similarities between the characters.
That 2B is right. On both of those characters, F Coma and H Coma.
Yep, and FWAR, a character that's got to be in the air a lot. So Poke having fought both of these two, we're going to see if he's got ways to safely maneuver around it for this site.
I feel like I've seen him pick C Waraki in this matchup too, actually.
Sure, so might happen.
Maybe he wants that ground movement more in this matchup. We'll see if he decides to stick with F. I'm sure he probably will, but that's always an option.
That's true, yeah. I mean, he even though he has the Siwara, he's been very comfortable in the F, you know, even in against Aiden's typically opted for the FWara, so we're going to have to see. I mean, the FWara mix-ups are just so strong, right?
Yeah, absolutely. How do you feel like FWara's defensive options are, just in general?
It's a tough one. I mean, I feel like the defensive options, just by being an F moon, you have EX guard, which I think is going to be very strong against H Coma, right? H Coma is going to try and stay in there to keep that strike throw enforcement, right? Where he can be in range to threaten with the command grab, and if Sapoke's EX guards are on point, he can do a better job of keeping that on. I think that's really going to be the most important thing there, because, you know, when you're defending against strike throw, right, or as we saw earlier, the way Aiden played against Phoebe, using the big kick to keep him grounded. I feel like you're a lot of times defensive options at a character level are just going to get trapped by a lot of those traps anyways, right? So I think just in being an F moon, having the ability to IH or instantly refill your health in general when you have the opportunity to heat might be an opportunity for Sapoke to make a comeback if the situation allows. But EX guard is, and having the full invincible shield counter probably the most important.
That's a good thing too in the matchup.
Gets the shield counter for Raynan, but does not convert.
Yeah.
Explosive start for Sapoke.
This is how he wants to get that momentum going to hopefully carry him.
Right. EX guard's not biting with the EX DP this time.
Yeah, it's funny how he turns that into a mix-up.
Right.
Turns him like doing something stupid like that. It's awesome.
But you know it works, right? Once you can definitely get got by it in one CD, you gotta respect it.
Aiden looking to get a hit here if he goes into max mode. That life back,
but tip of the drill catching there.
Yeah.
Crazy awareness. Really strong start for Sapoke here.
Just got hit raw by that killer too.
Right, I mean, he's doing a good job, it looks like, just catching aces high on some of the advancing movement there where you're holding forward to close space, you get tagged by the drill, but there's the command grab on the shield attempt.
Choosing to manually burst, because when you get hit before you're at max mode, and then you enter max mode as an H moon and you're still getting hit, you actually have the option to manually burst as opposed to typically
burst,
which is
auto burst. Yep. Maybe paying off? He was definitely pressing, but the startup after the flash working out is able to still block the DP.
Which is nice.
True.
No meter to,
goes for the shield after, and the counter hit conversion is Ty able to take a round back.
So close that round was.
It's crazy. It feels like we're seeing a different Sapoke today with so many more passive options I've ever seen him do.
Yeah. He bet it all on that shield, though, being low and high shield.
He really did. Shielding the arc drive, catches the jump out of auto burst. It's another good patient option. They're just sitting there and using the grounded normal to catch the jump. Retreating meatball?
Yeah, a lot of times when you see an H mode and max mode, you just try to throw out those moves that aren't going to get hit by the auto burst.
Right.
So that way you can stay in control or be more at advantage.
Aiden's been had a lot of awareness, just keep throwing out the 2B that we were talking about, but with air throw, though.
Yeah, but it looks like it hasn't really been working out for him yet in his first game.
Yeah, but you know, it's still establishing that fear for Sepoke to have to play around that and be wary of trying to just jump in. Sepoke just catching the rocket shoes with the spinner.
Yep. That's, I mean, he throws that move out a lot, and it works a lot. So.
He really does.
It's kind of hard to defend against, too. Even if you, like, block it, you're not necessarily always able to punish it.
Right. But the punish coming out there as Sive sneaks out with the 2-2-B.
Yep, Koma's, H-Koma's auto combo series does a really good job at progressing to the outside.
It's a poke with the full combo off the EX spinner.
Yeah, this is a hard knockdown, though, which is kind of what we're all about. Spends the meter before he goes into max mode. Very, very smart.
Right before max mode, too.
5k from H-Koma is crazy.
Actually. And wow, fast response to Raiden here.
Yeah, actually, so we talked about Waraki's defensive options as far as like how he defensively.
Did catch a a little too far! Unfortunate.
He was like over top of him. That was kind of crazy.
Right. I think maybe the frame gear didn't quite work out there. Might have still been a little bit invincible, trying to punish too soon. The auto burst coming out here. The poke just getting hit on Wake Up. Again.
Again, yeah, he's trying to jump.
Yep.
No death yet. He's trying to jump.
Yep, again. Red command grab every time, and sometimes you just get caught.
Yeah.
Fast tying up the set for Aiden here.
Maybe he just wanted the round to be over. I don't know. But, I mean, as far as that goes, too, when we were talking about Waraki's defensive options, he doesn't really have the best mashable buttons at the point either.
True.
So, he might be looking to jump out more often and try to mash out.
We'll have to see, and there's a hard knockdown, and getting a little low on the high shield attempt from Aiden here.
They're trying to wreck a through, and gets clipped with the second hit of that through.
Yep.
Thomas Rekka is pretty good at arm range for a couple games, but he only has that one hit of armor before.
There was that shield counter we mentioned, but Ace is high with the auto burst, just maintaining the corner and keeping offense going on Sepoke. The cold air throw on air type.
The triple back mash.
Spinner, you know, that's like the third time he's caught him pressing a button, but yep. It just hasn't been in range to get the punish.
Yeah, and he was scared to actually punish that that EX spinner too, because that meatball was right in his face. It was kind of funny.
Yeah, but the retreating JC working out. He catches Sepoke.
So Oak is doing a very good job of dodging
too. Yep. The spot dodge attempt. No conversion from Sepoke.
That was a pretty smart option. He gets armor from the Rekka too, so if he jumped in with a butt, the Rekka would have gone through. That's like some matchup knowledge right there.
I mean, match on as we said, right? They're players who have fought each other so much. Definitely a lot of things he's tested in this matchup. Wake up shield counter again. Waking up with the spinner. Does not get the full multi-shield, though.
I'm not sure if H-Koma can do that, actually.
I think you might be able to if you're able to time it right. He did get the first few shield attempts.
Because, I mean, we know he can't.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
Like auto-timing.
That's true, yeah, I forgot about that.
Gets clipped with the JC, the second hit.
This poke just flying right back over.
Alright, back to an even match here. It looked like for a moment there, Ace Asai was in sorrowfully from the end, but now some poke is managing to edge around here.
Yeah. Blocks the mix up and armors through with the Rekka! Great response to Sepoke pressing buttons.
Ooh, that
there.
Was a punish. And he had no meter to go for the X-Men. He gets caught trying to mash, it looked like.
5A answer. Clutch. 2A, it looks like catching a jump once again.
5C counter trade. Oh my.
Not enough to kill. One more chance for Sepoke here. Just getting walked all the way back to the corner again.
Oh, gets caught trying to jump out, it looked like.
Really quick 2A review tap there.
Yeah,
catching the toes.
It's tough. It's tough to get out of that pressure for sure. Especially when you don't have a character that can mash on the toes.
The round start gat attempt. It's unpunished. I like the boldness.
Knockdown. Oh, goes for the reset.
Left, right. I got hit.
There's probably like a safer set up there. No reason to do anything too risky when you got such a light lead, but Commander's system 2 get all of his life back.
Definitely. And that's the second time we saw him be successful with the Armored Rekka out of Sepok's pressure.
Oh, the command throw.
Not in position to combo either. Sepok spending on the spinner.
Oh, he tried to backdash it directly.
Just barely, too.
Yeah, he bet it all on that backdash there. He was not trying to block.
It looked like maybe trying to reach Sepok, trying to catch a last second heater or something, but Sepok just staying solid and throwing out the long normal to catch. And the air boot!
And it works out, and he gets a counter to JA.
Sepok just with the mash on wake up, paying off.
Oh my gosh, they are supposed to get each other, but nothing's happening.
It's so tense even for me, I'm just quietly watching who's gonna get hit. He's coming out, and Sepok not playing around this time.
Static combos are super cool.
They really are.
It's gonna kill.
Yep. Snuff, and it's tied up at 2-2. Just a poke threatening a reset. And here we are, growing the finals of poke threatening to reset at 2-2 here.
Nice punish. Playing a guessing game. 4K for Edge Combo's pretty good.
Sepok has been hit by every command grab in that situation.
Oh, he drops.
Does catch him though with the invalid. Sepok finding an opportunity to mash out a little bit of a meter charge, maybe hoping to get the. Just the insane mash through the armor. Sepok classic. Dodges the gat attempt again, no punish though.
He's got almost a 4 meter here. Oh.
The retreating meatball just barely slipping under Aiden's toes. And this is high on tournament point.
Alright, stuck in the corner, but he's got Zen Max now. Doesn't choose first. There he goes.
Sepok's getting out of there. Sepok now varying the timings of the retreating meatballs, trying to catch Aiden's high movement.
He's doing a very, very good job at catching up to Sepok when he chooses to run away and space out for those jokes.
Definitely, and the air shield with the pickup! This is how he gets thrown on corner offense now.
This could be the sequence that ends the game right here.
Yep. Ooh, but Sepok jumping the command grab this time! F4M accepts. Catches the Rekka attempt by just getting enough hits to break the armor.
That was an interesting
setup. Looked like an attempt to shield the Rekka, but slightly mistimed. Yeah, there it is. I think you're right. Maybe HB can't punish, but that should be enough!
He texts!
Texts out! Manages to escape! There's a poke with one more chance to hang on to his life.
Isisai does not have to play aggressively right now.
That was a brave tech. Maybe Aiden getting a little bit too comfortable with people just kind of taking that situation, knowing to be checkmate. Right.
Because he can just hit him with a 2C and a valid combo and kill him. So it was smart to tech.
Definitely was.
He's a side no meter.
And it's F4 mix up, but not enough time!
I didn't even notice the time.
I don't know.
We usually don't see it go to time. So.
Right, especially with these two characters.
Yeah, absolutely. But.
Ace is high, takes the tournament 3-2 over Sepok, not dropping a set.
Yep, Ace is high. I mean, in the Midwest, Ace is high is either winning, or it's either him or Jog, you know? Those
right.
are like the two. Jog, unfortunately, couldn't make it.
Right.
But Ace is high picking up the Koma.
Yep.
The Koma gauntlet medal and taking it all the way to grand finals.
And great stuff to everyone in the bracket. Lots of characters, regions represented here.
Yeah, it's actually kind of funny. Two F-Auras in top eight, two F-Arcs in top eight. So those are not characters you see all that often.
True.
In the top eight. So, but here in the Midwest, you see them all the time.
I mean, they're staple characters for us. More than a few of them here. As the applause goes off for our winners.
Oh, okay, awesome. Yeah, so we're going to wrap it up here, and we're going to go ahead and send it over to Game Arena Co., where they are having the Tekken Top 8. So thanks, everyone, for watching, and have a good one.